Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. Welcome to another edition of Friday Night Live with myself, Sulaiman Ravat. It's wonderful to be with you once again. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala bless us in the time that we will be spending together over the airwaves. You know, I want to commence with a thought this evening. Each one of us would proudly proclaim that I am a Muslim. Somebody asks you who you are, what faith do you practice, and you would proudly say, and you would say with a great degree of confidence and a great degree of pride, that I am a Muslim. But I think on a daily basis, if not daily, then at least every now and again, we need to just sit back and reflect and ponder over what it means to be a Muslim. And just to appreciate the beauty of this deen which Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has given us. Earlier today, the thought was crossing through my mind that if you look at a simple aspect of our deen, and that is the aspect of the different du'as that we are taught from the time we are small children. When you wake up in the morning, Alhamdulillah alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa ilayhi an-nushur. When you go to bed at night, Allahumma bi ismika amutu wa ahya. Before you eat, bismillah wa barakatillah. After you have eaten, Alhamdulillah alladhi at'amana wa saqana wa ja'alana muslimin. And like that, the number of du'as, the basic du'as, the day-to-day du'as, as they would mention, before you enter the toilet, when you leave the toilet. Now look at the beauty in this. This is just one aspect of deen that I'm talking about. At every moment in your routine activities, going to bed, waking up, eating, completing your meal, going to the bathroom, coming out of a bathroom, wearing clothes, all of this is part of your daily routine. This is part of what we spend the majority of our life doing. Look at the beauty in this. Firstly, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is saying, if I have decreed for you 60 years of life, from that 60 years, maybe you would spend 5-6 years just eating, drinking, sleeping and wearing clothes, if not more. I'm just giving an example off the top of my head. So why let that number of years or that percentage of your life just go to waste like that? Every time you're wearing your clothes, Alhamdulillah alladhi kasani ma uwari bihi awrati wa atajammalu bihi fi hayati. You read the dua for wearing clothes. Every time you eat, you read the dua. Every time you sleep, you read the dua. You are remembering Allah at every junction. So all of those actions of yours become an ibadah. Number one. Number two, it creates that consciousness and it keeps that consciousness in your mind. When you wake up in the morning, rather than waking up with a hangover, you are waking up taking the name of Allah. Alhamdulillah alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa ilayhi an-nushur. Rather than starting off your day with some material need or with some material goal, you start off by performing your fajr salah, remembering Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, making dua to Allah, making tilawat of the Quran, reciting the Quran, and now you set forth with your tasks for the day, with your chores for the day, with your duties for the day. Rather than going to bed with your last action being something impermissible, something trivial, something mundane, you take the name of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allahumma bi ismika amutu wa ahyam. You recite the du'as that are masnoon, that were prescribed by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be recited before you go to bed. So this is just one aspect, the different ad'iyah, the different du'as that we have been taught. It's something very, very simple in our deen, simple in the sense that it's something we taught to do from the time we are young, the dua for this and the dua for that. But just this one aspect of our deen, look at how it beautifies a person's life. At every moment you're acknowledging, my Allah is there, He's the one who gave me clothes. My Allah is the one who brought the food to me. My Allah is the one who gives me the ability to take in the food. My Allah is the one who gives this body the ability to take benefit from the food. My Allah is the one who ensures that the remains thereafter escape from the body. At every juncture we're acknowledging the greatness of Allah, the oneness of Allah, the perfection of Allah. And like that, a believer, whilst doing what everyone else does, they also have to wake up, sleep, drink, eat, dress, go and relieve themselves. They do all of that, but they do it in a very different manner. But when you prescribe to the kalima, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, becomes a different ball game, as they say. Now what they say? Now you are doing things which have been taught to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which bring beauty into your life, which bring meaning into your life, which bring significance into insignificant actions. Go and ask a non-Muslim that, is there any significance to dressing? apart from, you know, wanting to show off and wanting to look prim and proper for the boyfriend or girlfriend or trying to impress in the workplace, he'll say, dressing is something you just have to do. Eating is something you have to do. Enjoying the food, that's a different thing. I'm talking about just the mere process of eating. Yet, even before we put that morsel in the mouth, we're acknowledging Allah, we're appreciating what has happened, we're understanding what has taken place in order for that meal to come before us and in order for us to take benefit from it. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant us the understanding in that regard. Coming up this evening on the edition of Friday Night Live, as usual, we've got a few new features in the program in case you missed the last one or two episodes. We're going to start with a dua that will be followed by a hadith. Then we do tafsir. Then we discuss one or two aspects of current affairs. Then our story or anecdote for the week. After that, our seerah feature. Then we discuss marriage. And finally, we conclude with a sunnah for the week. In terms of dua, today we'll be discussing a dua from the Quran that is recommended by Allah, that we utilize those words to make dua for our parents. In terms of the hadith, we continue the series of discussions on akhlaaq and good character from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Tafseer for this week, we'll be talking about how valuable is Iman, your belief in Allah, in the oneness of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Current affairs, well, Nkandla gate, Gupta gate, these are the two issues that dominated headlines the entire week. We'll also speak a little bit perhaps about Timbuktu and what transpired there. In terms of our story for the week, we're keeping that theme on the love of Sahaba for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Our seerah feature, we're still doing a few introductory points before starting with the actual life story of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then when it comes to the marriage feature, we talk about the importance of dua. And finally, we conclude with our sunnah for the week, where we encourage you to implement whatever sunnah we discuss. So at least one new sunnah comes into our life every week. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala bless us and may He grant us the ability to say that which is correct and to most importantly practice upon it and thereafter propagate it to humanity. Welcome back to Friday Night Live. We now move on to our dua feature. Last week we spoke about the dua that Adam alayhi salatu wasalam made that led to his the acceptance of his tawbah being confirmed by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala was going to forgive Adam alayhi salatu wasalam because Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was sincere in his repentance, he was sincere in his remorse. But then Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala taught him a few words through which he sought the pardon of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And when he did that, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala confirmed that he had been forgiven. And in reality, it's a great blessing and boon for us because these words are preserved in the Quran and we can call out unto Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala with these words. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا. Oh Allah, we have greatly oppressed ourselves. وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Allah, if you don't forgive us and if you don't show mercy upon us, then we turn out and we end up being from the losers. And I explained last week, the devil was blatant in his transgression. He was intentional in his violating the command of Allah, yet he refused to be humble and he refused to show remorse. He tried to blame it on Allah, waliyadu billah, saying, oh Allah, you misguided me. And as a result, he remains accursed up to today. On the other hand, Adam alayhi salam was not blatant in his disobedience. It was a mistake, a misunderstanding, a lapse, forgetting. But on the other, notwithstanding that, he showed utmost remorse, utmost humility. Look at his words. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا. Oh Allah, we have greatly oppressed ourselves. And Allah, if you don't forgive us, you don't show mercy on us, who can we turn to, oh Allah? What beautiful words. We can ask Allah for forgiveness in any language, in any words, but if we use the words mentioned by Allah that He taught Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, our forefather, obviously there will be more effect and more impact in it. Now, moving on to this week's dua. This dua is a dua that is recommended in the Quran for us to make on behalf of our parents. And it is also a dua that was taught to us by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. It's in the 15th juz of the Quran Kareem, Surah Banu Israel, the beginning of the third ruku. Now the first verse of this ruku, and the dua is in the second verse. The first verse talks about the importance of respecting your parents. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah says, it has been decreed and it's compulsory that you worship only Allah. Allah talks about Tawheed. Worshipping Allah, believing in the oneness of Allah. And immediately after Tawheed, Allah talks about being kind to your parents, being good to your parents. Showing and telling us that in terms of ibadah and worship, after worshipping Allah alone, the most important thing is be kind to your parents. They are the apparent means through which you came into existence. Obviously, Allah is the creator, but Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has designed a system. There's a cause and effect procedure. There are means. So your parents were the means of you coming into existence. And they showed great kindness to you, and they showed great mercy on you, and they did a lot for you. So Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala emphasizes the position of parents and the importance of showing respect and being good to your parents. And then in the next verse, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala teaches us a dua. Rabbirhamhuma kama rabbayani saghira. Rabbirhamhuma kama rabbayani saghira. Oh my Allah, show mercy on my mother and my father like they showed mercy on me when I was little. When you were a small baby, they had to clothe you, feed you, soothe you, stay up in the middle of the night with you, breastfeed you, wean you, change your nappies, look out for you so that you don't harm yourself, teach you to walk, teach you to talk, teach you to do all of the basics that you ended up then doing without even thinking. Now then later on in life, you eat and you drink and you talk and you walk. It's second nature to you. But all of this, your parents taught you. And they showed great mercy. They didn't get frustrated. They didn't neglect you. They didn't abandon you. Even though you were compromising their sleep. Even though you were a great financial burden upon them. Even though when visitors would come, sometimes you would be so irritating. All those difficulties you put them through, but they showed mercy upon you. Now you return the favor. How? By asking the most merciful of those who show mercy, Arhamur Rahimeen, that, oh Allah, you shower your mercy upon my parents because they showered mercy upon me when I was young. And obviously the mercy that Allah will shower upon them is far greater than the mercy that they showered upon us. So in reality, we're doing our parents a great, great favor and showing gratitude in a big way by making this dua. What a sweet, short, yet such a beautiful and touching dua. Rabbirhamhuma كما ربياني صغيرا امين يا رب العالمين
من ذا يفرج كربا بات يضنينا من ذا يفرج كربا بات يضنينا.
Welcome back to Friday Night Live. We now move on to our hadith segment discussing the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah, people discuss the words of Shakespeare and others discuss the words of an author or an orator. We are discussing the words of the darling of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, the most beloved of the entire creation to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And the theme of the ahadith that we're discussing at the moment has got to do with good character. Last week we discussed a hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to us that by means of good character, you can reach the stages and you can reach the rewards of those people who fast in abundance and those people who perform salah in abundance. Just by you having good character, you can reach and you can secure the rewards of those who fast abundantly, those who wake up in the middle of night and perform salah and read lengthy passages of the Quran in that salah. To make tahajjud is not easy, and as a result the reward is great. To be perpetually fasting or fasting regularly, that is not easy, the reward is great. Then we discussed the hadith last week as well, that the heaviest of deeds on the scale of deeds will be good character. Deeds will be weighed on the day of Qiyamah. And that action which will carry the most weight when good and bad actions are weighed will be good character. And we discussed a third hadith last week where Mu'adh bin Jabal radiallahu anh says that as Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was bidding him farewell and indicating to him that you won't meet me again after this in all likelihood, the last advice that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him was that ensure that your character and your conduct is good. Beautify your conduct for the people, O Mu'adh bin Jabal. Now on the same theme, we discuss a few more hadith this week. The first hadith narrated by Jabir radiallahu anh, it is recorded in the Sunan of Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah. And Jabirin radiallahu anhu, anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, inna min ahabbikum ilayya wa aqrabikum minni majlisan yawm al-qiyamah ahasinakum akhlaqan. Undoubtedly, amongst you, the most beloved and nearest to me on the day of Qiyamah will be those having the most excellent conduct. You know, during the month of Rabiul Awal, a lot of discussion on Seerah. And we pour out our hearts in terms of the love that we have for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if we want Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to love us, and if we want to be close to him on the day of Qiyamah, on a day of great tribulation and great difficulty, then remember this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those of you who will be the most beloved to me and closest to me on the day of Qiyamah, sitting closest to me, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be the recipient of the greatest mercy of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah. Those sitting closest to him and sharing that mercy are those who are good in their conduct. If your character is good and your conduct is good, you secure the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, number one. And number two, you will secure a seat close to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of Qiyamah. Then there is another hadith. Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu narrates this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also in the Sunan of Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah. He mentions that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said, أَلَا أُخْبِرُكُمْ بِمَنْ يَحْرُمُ عَلَى النَّارِ وَبِمَنْ تَحْرُمُ عَلَيْهِ النَّارِ عَلَى كُلِّ قَرِيبٍ هَيِّنٍ سَهْلٍ أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, shall I not inform you about the person who is forbidden for the hellfire, and the hellfire is forbidden for him? And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the answer, anyone who is close to people, who is soft and lenient. A person who is close to others and who is soft and who is lenient. Meaning, when you are close to people, you can only get close to people if you have good conduct. Otherwise, people will abhor you. People won't like you. People will distance themselves from you. But when people are close to you, it's a sign of good conduct. And at the same time, so you, number one, you are close to people. Number two, hayyin. You are soft-spoken. You are soft and sahlin, you are lenient, meaning you're an accommodating person. You're not a person who allows himself to be taken advantage of all the time. Obviously that the Sharia doesn't want, but you're accommodating, you're understanding, you're tolerant, you're generous. These are all qualities of a person whose conduct is good. And if your conduct is good, you are haram for the fire of Jahannam, and the fire of Jahannam is haram for you. You are haram for the fire of Jahannam, and the fire of Jahannam is haram for you. Subhanallah. So what we've learned from today, this week's discussion, two things. If you want to become the beloved of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and enjoy a seat closer to him on day of Qiyamah, have good conduct. If you want to become haram for the fire of Jahannam, meaning you'll never go there, and the fire of Jahannam is haram for you, meaning it'll never want you, then have good conduct. Those are the words and the promises of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. Welcome back to Friday Night Live. We move on to our Tafseer segment now. And last week we discussed verse number 35 of Surah Al-Ma'idah, where Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala mentions, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, that O you who believe, ittaqullah, fear Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, wabtaghu ilayhi al-wasilah, and seek a means of coming closer to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. وَجَاهِدُوا فِي سَبِيلِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ, and strive in the path of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala so that you can become successful. Now we explained that we can look at this word wasila from two ways. You can look at it from the literal meaning, and in terms of the literal meaning, it means to seek closeness. So how do you seek closeness to Allah? How do you come closer to Allah? We discussed last week that every act of ibadah, every act of obedience and worship will bring you closer to Allah. But then there is priorities. The fara'id bring you closer to Allah more quickly and more effectively because it's a compulsory act. But then it doesn't mean you must ignore nawafil like we do today, because nawafil make you very beloved to Allah. And when you become the beloved of Allah, you are successful in this world as well as in the hereafter. So fara'id and nawafil, we should ensure that we remain punctual on them, because these are the instructions of Allah. And the more you comply with the instructions of Allah, the closer you will come to Allah. And we explained last week as well that we must put it on our list of goals and our list of objectives. Every now and again, we must ask ourselves the question, what am I doing to come closer to my Allah? And what is that in my life that is taking me away from my Allah and distancing me from my Allah? And then the second aspect we discussed, we said you can look at this word wasila as in light of a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that wasila is the highest rank in Jannah, above which there is no rank. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has encouraged us, his ummah, to make dua to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to grant him that lofty status. And we make that dua every day, or five times a day when we hear the adhan. After the adhan, we make the dua. which contains the words Ati Muhammadan al-Wasila, that, oh Allah, grant Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that position of Wasila. Now, if you, the one was the literal translation, Wasila meaning coming closer to Allah, and that literal translation also fits here, that do whatever you can do to come closer to your Allah. That's what the Muslims are being encouraged to do. And the second thing is this particular position. Now here in the second interpretation, people could say, well, that position is already given to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so how can we seek it? And we explained last week that take the example of hidayat and guidance. The highest position of hidayat and guidance has been given to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but yet we make dua for hidayat and guidance every time we read Surah Fatiha, ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, that Allah guide us to the straight path. So it means that the highest rank in that particular aspect is granted to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but we can seek the lower ranks. So the highest rank of hidayat and guidance is granted to the Nabi of Allah, but we also seek hidayat and guidance, trying to come as close as we possibly can. So similarly with wasila, that great position on the day of Qiyamah, the ultimate of it, the pinnacle of it is granted to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but we must endeavor to see how close we can come. Now today we are going to be discussing the next two verses, 36 and 37 of Surah Al-Ma'idah. In 36, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala mentions, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْ أَنَّ لَهُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ لِيَفْتَدُوا بِهِ مِنْ عَذَابِ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ مَا تُقُبِّلَ مِنْهُمْ وَلَهُمْ أَعْذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ يُرِيدُونَ أَنْ يَخْرُجُوا مِنَ النَّارِ وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنْهَا وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُقِيمٌ. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala talks about those who died as unbelievers. On the day of Qiyamah, when they see the punishment that awaits them, and already in the grave, they would be going through many difficulties, because the condition in the grave, as we all know, it is either rawdatun min riyad al-jinan. If you are a good person and you died in a good state, then your grave will become a garden from the gardens of paradise. Your introduction to enjoyment and happiness will start. Or otherwise, it can be hufratun min hufarin niran. It can be a pit from the pits of hellfire. If you died in a bad state, Allah forbid, and if your resurrection is going to be in a bad state, and if your deeds were evil. So already in the grave, they would have tasted a portion of that punishment, because they died in the state of disbelief. But now when they are being resurrected, the full reality of what their condition is going to be will hit them, and hit them very hard, because they will realize now that for unbelievers, the punishment is eternal. The punishment will never cease. It will never come to an end. And the situation will be so desperate on that day that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala mentions, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, those who had disbelieved, لَوْ أَنَّ لَهُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. Hypothetically speaking, if we had granted them wealth, the equivalent of the entire world, وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ, and double that. If we had granted them so much wealth that it could fill the whole world twice. That's what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is saying. If they had that much wealth, they would, without blinking an eye, give all of that wealth away just to ransom themselves from this punishment, just to free themselves from this punishment. لِيَفْتَدُوا بِهِ مِنْ عَذَابِ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ, from the punishment on the day of Qiyamah. But Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says that it won't be accepted from them. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ, and their punishment is an excruciating one. And this theme is found in other verses of the Quran as well. The concluding verse of the third juz of the Quran, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala mentions, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ كُفَّارُ, those who disbelief, and then they die in a state of disbelief. Remember, as long as you are alive, if you make tawbah from kufar or shirk, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will accept your tawbah. Sahaba were worshipping idols, they were involved in shirk. They made tawbah, Allah wiped the slate clean, and they became the best of human beings in the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But if you die in a state of disbelief, other actions, I mean, if you commit zina and you didn't make tawbah, if you stole and you didn't make tawbah, obviously it's better you make tawbah. But even if you didn't make tawbah, it's at the discretion of Allah. If Allah wants, He can forgive you, even if you didn't make tawbah and you died without making tawbah. But kufr and shirk, Allah has the capacity to forgive it even after a person has passed away, because we are all the creation of Allah. But Allah in His wisdom has decreed that you, when it comes to kufr and shirk, you have the duration of your lifetime to make tawbah. But once your life is expired, and Allah forbid if you die in a state of kufr, then there is no punishment. Allah has passed that judgment upon him, has passed that judgment and said, I won't forgive that. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ كُفَّارُ. In this verse, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, the verse from the third juz, فَلَيْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمْ مِلْءُ الْأَرْضِ ذَهَبًا. If they came with so much gold that it could fill the whole world and say, take this gold but don't punish us, it would not be accepted from them. It would not be accepted from them. So That's the value of Iman, that you cannot substitute Iman with the equivalent of this world filled with gold. The value of Iman is such, if somebody brings wealth that can fill the world twice, even that cannot be a substitute and cannot compensate for the fact that that person passed away without Iman. In Surah Ma'arij, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala mentions that on the day of Qiyamah, that what they will try and do, forget gold and forget wealth, they will try and ransom their own children, their own parents, their own spouses, thinking that, you know what, take my son, take my daughter, take my wife, take my parents, take whoever you want and do whatever you want to them. Just save me from the punishment. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says, Kalla innaha lava nazza'atan lishawa. Then Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala goes on to describe the punishments of the day of Qiyamah. So that is the value of Iman. Now, whilst these verses talk about the unbeliever, what will be the condition of the unbeliever on the day of Qiyamah, that nothing can compensate for the fact that they didn't die in the state of Iman. That's how valuable Iman is. In that next verse, 36, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says, one is they'll have excruciating punishment on the day of Qiyamah. Then after that, you know, moving forward in Jahannam, يُرِيدُونَ أَن يَخْرُجُوا مِنْهَا وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنْهَا يُرِيدُونَ أَن يَخْرُجُوا مِنَ النَّارِ وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنْهَا. They would try every attempt to come out of the fire of Jahannam, but they won't be successful. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُقِيمٌ. It will be a permanent punishment, because it was a permanent sin. They lived their entire lives without making tawbah from disbelief, from kufr and shirk. So the punishment is also a permanent one. Now, how does it relate to us? We may think, well, alhamdulillah, we are Muslims. We are Muslims now, but there's no guarantee that you will die with Iman. As you live your life, so will you die. Now the question we need to ask ourselves, am I living the life of a Muslim? Am I leading my existence as per the dictates of Iman? If not, I'm exposing myself to potentially, Allah forbid, leaving this world without Iman. So being a Muslim now is no guarantee that you'll die with Iman or that you'll be resurrected with Iman. But if you live your life as a Muslim, then inshallah you'll die as a Muslim and you'll die with your Iman and you'll be resurrected with Iman. That's why we must always make an effort to be obedient servants of Allah so that it preserves our Iman and enhances our Iman. I've mentioned this previously, the quality of Iman increases. Al-Imanu yazidu wa yanqus. Also, we must make dua to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala for the preservation of Iman. One dua to make, Allahumma barik lana fil maut wa fima ba'd al maut. Oh Allah, grant us barakah at the time of death and the period which follows death. We need the barakah of Allah at all times, but we need it more so at the time when we are dying, because then we don't want to be deprived of Iman. And thirdly, the ulama say, there's a principle in the Quran where Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says, La in shakartum la azidannakum. If you show gratitude to me, then I will increase you. So daily we must show gratitude to Allah for this bounty of Iman, the greatest bounty. And the best way of showing gratitude is to live your life as per the instructions and the dictates of Iman. But even a verbal gratitude or 2 rakats of salah every day or whenever we remember, in the hope that if I show gratefulness to my Allah for my Iman, Allah will protect my Iman, because it's such a valuable thing. Look at how desperate those who don't have it when they leave this dunya will be on the day of Qiyamah. May Allah make us live the lives of those who truly have Iman. Take us with good quality Iman. Resurrect us in the company of those whose Iman was of the highest caliber. And grant us Jannatul Firdaus without reckoning. Ameen Ya Rabbal Alameen. Welcome back to Friday Night Live. We now move on to our current affairs segment and we take a look at one or two stories that dominated headlines in the last week. The one story that dominated headlines was what is now being dubbed and what is now being called Nkandla Gate. On Friday, the Minister of Public Works, Tulisi Ngesi, at a press briefing announced that no state money was used for the development of the personal houses of President Jacob Zuma at his residence in Nkandla. Rather, 206 million rand was used for security upgrades. And how did they break it down? He said 50 million for the actual security features, 20 million for consultants, that gives you 70 million plus minus, and approximately 130 million for operational costs. Now, how did he explain operational costs? He said, you got all the different departments that had to play a part in these security upgrades. So they had to send people there, it took some time. So they built a clinic for the staff, and they built houses, and they built a tuck shop. And all of that cost about 130 million. So 206 million rand spent. And the argument was that this was spent only for security upgrades. They were very adamant in saying the president didn't know about how much it would cost. This was a public works project, and they knew the details, those who were handling the actual project, etc. The ANC came out saying, look, the president has been vindicated. There were fingers being pointed against him, suggesting that he had used public money to upgrade his own homes, etc. Whatever work was done in terms of the houses of the president, that was done at his own cost. Now, it looks like a big place, a huge place, and there would be one question there, that where did the president, who I think gets about 2 million salary a month, where did he get that amount of money? But that's a separate question and a separate issue altogether. Now there's 206 million. I think the concerning fact was the way they said it, as if 206 million is just 206 million. And we spoke earlier in the week, I had interviewed the advisor to the Minister of Public Works, Tulis Nglesi, he said that, I said to him, even if it was only for security, 206 million, when we're living in times where people are going to bed hungry, people don't have roofs over their heads, people are struggling, people are striking, there are job cuts. Don't you think it's obscene? Don't you think it's ridiculous? Don't you think it doesn't make sense? And his response was, well, we're not taking from the budgets of any other department. And if other budgets are not enough, then that must be discussed as a separate issue. We are well within our budget. And that's scary, isn't it? To think what the budget must be like for public works. And this is a residence where the president is not expected to spend that much of time. He's got two official residences in Pretoria and in Cape Town. And I see Kosatu have also come out lambasting this huge amount of money that has been spent. And to what degree was there security threats? Now, obviously, they don't want to discuss this. They say it will compromise the security of the president. Although when we interviewed Bantu Holomisa earlier in the week, he did say that, listen, in Parliament, you've got, for example, the Portfolio Committee on Intelligence. All the members, they are screened. So if you release the report to them, this report which they are keeping confidential at the moment, if you release it to them and you say to them that you look at it and you see if the expenses were justified, they're not going to compromise the security of the president in any way, because there are people who are whose background has been checked and whose credentials have been screened. So the DA wants to go to court now. The public protector and the auditor general are carrying out their own investigations. The key issue for me here is about the understanding of accountability and the understanding of what to do with public funds. And, you know, we don't want to go into a lengthy discussion, but how concerned true leaders were, if we look at our past, history of Muslims, you know, true, like the Khulafa Rashidin, etc., every cent. How when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu would be finished with official work, he would off the lantern in his home and say, now my official work is over, I can't use the state lantern anymore. Those kind of incidents, and there's so many of them. Now, the point here is that, number one, if the president didn't know what it was costing, he could see what was happening, why didn't he ask? You don't expect the president to know the nitty-gritties of every project. I mean, he's running a whole country. There are different departments, and within those departments, there are a whole host of projects. But when something's happening on your own doorstep, if you are the CEO of a country, if you are a CEO of a company, and you see some massive developments taking place in the entrance of the building from where the company runs, even though it's not running directly under your command, you would ask, you would be expected to ask. And if you didn't ask, you would be questioned, why didn't you ask? What's this costing here? Because at the moment, the company is going through the difficult period, we're trying to cut costs. What's this costing us? And if you don't ask, you would be criticized for not asking. So that's a question that remains. Why didn't the president ask? Now, the whole debate then becomes around, the usage of public funds so loosely and spending so extravagantly in times of great difficult need for others. How insensitive. Now, one is we will sit and we will comment and we will give our own analysis and throw our 50 cents worth, as some would say. But then we also need to look at our own lives every now and again. That Allah has given some of us a lot of wealth. Some of us, maybe not that much, but sufficient, you know, what they call the middle class. And how sometimes we are totally insensitive to the conditions of others around us and we spend extravagantly. Our weddings are just one example in that regard. How people will spend hundreds of thousand rands just on the decor. We're not saying that go into a totally empty hall with, nothing. If you want to put a few tablecloths and make it look a bit presentable, understood. But hundreds of thousands of rands on the decor? Huge amounts on the photography for the occasion, huge amounts on just the flowers. Allahu Akbar, are they not greater needs? Are people not going to bed without food in their bellies? We'll have to answer for this extravagance in front of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Then another issue that has been dominating headlines this week has been the whole Gupta Gate, the saga between Helen Ziller and the New Age. when the city press broke the news that the New Age gets big sponsorships from state-owned enterprises like Telkom and like Eskom and Transnet, etc., Helen Zille pulled out of the breakfast briefing. And she said she didn't know they were getting big bucks from state-owned enterprises. And then the whole thing became an issue about the Guptas, that they supporting ANC and Zuma. And now they get, as a result, a kickback via the state-owned enterprises that sponsors big money to their breakfast briefings. Having said that, though, there was a video then that came to the fore where at a previous breakfast briefing, Helen Zille had thanked Telkom for sponsoring the event. So that was a bit of a difficulty for her. Then she was accused of double standards and hypocrisy when this whole story came to the fore that she took a donation from the Guptas. Initially, she said, no, it was an individual who worked for the Guptas. He made it quite clear it was his personal money. He just wanted me to pick it up at the Guptas' residence. And she said there she ate the best food she had ever tasted. Somebody asked her, what food was it? She said it was all vegetarian food, and the cook was from India. So I think it's a tribute to Indians and their cuisine. Helen Zille says the best food that she has ever eaten. Then later on, to me, it sounded like a contradiction when they produced a letter. But hey, here's a letter where you wrote to Atul Gupta, the managing director of Sahara, saying that thank you for the donation and thank you for the assistance, and we managed to achieve this in the elections. She said, no. Initially, we thought it was the Guptas, but that time there was no controversy around them. Then we realized it was an individual donor, and we changed the receipt and the thank you letter. And later on, when there was some question marks over the Guptas and their whole association with President Zuma, then I issued an instruction that we shouldn't take any money from them. The story just didn't seem to gel all that well. Now there's accusations that the New Age newspaper is getting so much funding from different departments in terms of their advertising with the New Age and sponsoring, that 77% of their income is coming from government money. If indeed this is true, it's something that that needs to be looked at. But again, all of this boils down to this whole thing. You know, when it comes to leadership, sincerity and honesty. Now, we might say, yeah, you see, we got corrupt politicians, those in the media corrupt. Everyone is just worried about filling their own pockets. But then, a'malukum, a'malukum, your own actions become your leaders. Don't we lead similar lives also? Not worrying about ethics, not worrying about morals. See how we can make a bigger profit. The bottom line is what counts. So we need to sometimes take lesson from all these happenings in the world. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant us their realization. Welcome back to Friday Night Live. We now move on to our anecdote or story for the week. Last week we discussed the story of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, as mentioned in Hayatul Sahaba, how on the occasion of Makkah, after waiting for conquest of Makkah, after waiting for 2 decades, finally his father Abu Quhafa decides to accept Islam. And this was a dream come true for Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Yet when his father Abu Quhafa was putting his hands in the hands of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to take the bay'at of Islam, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu started to cry. And when Sahaba asked him if he was crying tears of joy, he said no, he was crying tears of regret. Because at that moment he was regretting that instead of his father Abu Quhafa accepting Islam, if only it could have been the uncle of Abu Talib, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Talib, accepting Islam. Because he wanted to give preference to the greatest dream of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam over his own dream and his wish. His dream and wish was that his father accept Islam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's dream and wish was that his uncle Abu Talib accept Islam. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu saw his dream become fulfilled in his lifetime. But in that happiness, there was sadness that my Nabi's dream was not fulfilled. I would rather sacrifice my dream in favor of the dream of my Nabi getting fulfilled. That is how Sahaba loved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they gave preference to the love of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam over their own desires and their own goals and their own objectives. Today I want to discuss a hadith. There was a Sahabi who came to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I love you so much. It's an incident which is mentioned in this hadith. I love you so much that I'm prepared to sacrifice my parents, my offspring, my siblings, my business, even myself. Everything, I can give it up for you. That's how much I love you. And then he went on to say something really remarkable. He said, Ya Rasulullah, when I'm at home, when I'm at my business, when you come to mind, when I start thinking of you, I get so restless that I can't continue with my business. I can't continue with my wife or with my children. I immediately have to leave everything, drop it as is, and rush to Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and enter your gathering just to get one glimpse of your blessed face. I get so restless when you come to mine, and when I start thinking of you, I can't do anything else, I have to come and see you. And then he said, Ya Rasulullah, but I have one concern. My concern is this, that death is definitely going to overtake me one day. And death will also overpower you one day. Both of us have to leave this world. Now your position is guaranteed. You are a Nabi and you are the greatest of Allah's creation. So after death, you will go to the highest ranks of Jannah. I consider myself an ordinary person. Even if I make it to Jannah, I will most likely be in the lower ranks. Ya Rasulullah, my worry is this, that what will be the point of going to Jannah? What pleasure will there be in Jannah if I am deprived of your companionship? Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. He's saying, Ya Rasulullah, what's the point of me going to Jannah if I can't see you? That was the love that Sahaba had for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then consoled him, and as we know, the Nabi of Allah has taught us that if you love somebody genuinely, you'll be resurrected with that person and you will enjoy that person's company. Your stages will be different, but Allah will make it such that you'll be able to see that person and you'll be able to meet that person from time to time and enjoy the company of that particular person. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant us the true love of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So even though we have not seen him, but we will be resurrected in his company because we had true love. And we will drink from his blessed hands at the Hawd al-Kawthar. And we will be granted his sight and his companionship in Jannah. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Welcome back to Friday Night Live. We now move on to our Seerah feature. And it's a new feature in the program. It's only the third week that we have the Seerah feature. And we discussed in the previous 2 weeks that if a person is not acquainted with the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you can never be acquainted with Iman and Islam and its realities. We are discussing a few introductory points before we come to the actual discussion on the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I've mentioned last week and the week before, it's more important for you to acquaint yourself with the life of the Nabi than it is for you to acquaint yourself with your own Iman. Because if you don't know the life of your Nabi, you're not going to know what Iman is, what Islam is, and how to fulfill the requisites and the dictates of Iman and Islam. Then last week we also mentioned that the Anbiya, the Prophets, are the links between the creation and the Creator. Without the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, we don't know what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wants from us, and we don't know how to go about fulfilling the commands of Allah and pleasing Allah. That's why the Quran is replete with different incidents of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, to this extent that not only does Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala discuss the story of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam in the Quran, he also has named a number of the surahs of the Quran, the chapters of the Quran, after the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. Surah Yunus, Surah Yusuf, Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Now the point that we want to make for this week is a very important point, that every Nabi came with his hidayat and guidance. Every Nabi came with that which was beneficial for mankind, even though they were sent to a limited amount of people, unlike Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who was sent to the entire mankind. But unfortunately, the lives, the teachings, the traditions and the legacy of the other Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam has not been preserved. We get drips and drabs a little bit here in terms of what Ibrahim alayhi salam may have said, Musa alayhi salam may have said, what we pick up from the Quran and the Ahadith, what we pick up from Nabi sallallahu alayhi salam. Now if you take Nabi sallallahu alayhi salam out of the equation, you take Quran and Sunnah out of the equation, we know nothing about the previous Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. Because the previous nations, they couldn't preserve the book which Allah had sent them. Where were they going to preserve the teachings of the Nabi of the time and the instructions and the prohibitions of the Nabi of the time? But this ummah has been so blessed by Allah that our Quran is preserved, and also the legacy of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is preserved. Every statement of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have a chain of narrators that the ulama are aware of before that statement will be narrated as an accurate statement of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is substantiated. Substantiation, who narrated it, whom he narrated it from, how could he possibly have narrated it from that person? What's his background? What's that person's background? There's an entire science of jarah and ta'deel looking into the backgrounds of the narrators of ahadith. So the science of hadith has preserved the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the actions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the descriptions of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what sahaba could say, how many white hairs he had, and up till today it's preserved. What he said on the occasion of Hajjatul Wida, up to today it's preserved. Now how does this link up with Seerah? The the other umam, people who came after the other anbiya, couldn't read up on their lives and couldn't study their lives because it wasn't preserved to the extent that the life of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been preserved in such great detail. Now that's a great bounty of Allah upon us. We will only be robbing ourselves of a great opportunity that we have that bounty. The great life of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been preserved in great detail. It's authentic. We know the chain of narrators. We know who's telling us the story. Yet we don't benefit from it. We don't learn more about it. We don't take the lessons behind it. Indeed, that will be a great indictment upon us. So it's a great advantage of this ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam over the previous nations that the life of our Nabi has been preserved in great detail. We need to now, meaning the bowl is full. We need to drink from that bowl and we need to benefit from that bowl. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. We now come to the final feature of our program, in many ways the most important one, because this one is where we want immediate implementation inshallah, and that's our sunnah for the week. In our last discussion, we spoke about when should the tablecloth, the dastarkhan, be lifted, and we discuss a hadith from the sunnah of Imam Ibn Majah rahimahullah, where Aisha radiyallahu anha mentions that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam prevented them from getting up before the tablecloth was taken away. Then there's the narration of Ibn Umar radiyallahu anhumam, where he mentions that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam had said, once the tablecloth has been laid, no one should stand up until it's taken away. And the whole rationale and wisdom behind this is that if the tablecloth is still down, it means people are still eating. And if others start to stand up and walk away, those who are eating will feel bad. Because some people eat a bit slower, some people take a bit more time. Now, if others start standing up and walking away, you rush those people and maybe they're hungry, they still want to eat. I mentioned last week, if you have a justified excuse, then understood. Maybe you need to go somewhere and you excuse yourself, or maybe others came quite late, but there's a group of them and they will continue eating. It's not just one, two of them. And as a group, they won't feel isolated, then it's fine. But look at the consideration that's given. And that's the sunnah I want to discuss this week. Consideration when dishing out. Jabir bin Abdullah radiallahu anhu narrates that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one day passed him and told him, come with me. He took him home. The wife of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was behind the veil. He asked, what is there to eat? She said, three slices of bread. Three slices of bread. Imagine today a home where there's only three slices of bread. The Nabi of Allah took one slice, he put it before himself. He served himself. He took another slice, he put it before Jabir radiallahu anhu. He took the third slice, he broke it in half and he shared it between himself and Jabir radiallahu anhu. The benefit of serving himself first, he didn't want Jabir radiallahu anhu to feel isolated, that like, he's feeding me but he's not eating, so he's watching me now how much I'm going to eat. By serving himself first, it shows that I'm eating a full one, so you eat a full one, don't worry. And I'm taking half, so you take the other half as well. And the second point, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shared it equally. Sometimes what happens when we sit in the dastarkhan, that we want all the drumsticks, or we want all the white meat, or we want the cold water. We're not considerate to other people who are eating with us. We spoke about the tablecloth as well. In another hadith it is mentioned that when you are eating from one plate, if the others have finished eating, others are still eating and you finish, continue to puck, as we would say in our terminology. Eat a little so they don't feel isolated. Even on the dastarkhan, even on the tablecloth, consideration of others is important. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. That brings us to the end of Friday Night Live for this evening. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala accept. As always, we want your feedback. The email, as it would appear on your screen, smr@itvnetworks.tv. There's Facebook, there's Twitter, and there's the website as well. Communicate through whichever means you prefer. And until we meet again, remember us in your du'as. Keep well, keep safe, be happy. Fi amanillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بالجهالة قد خابت مساعينا تاحينا وينشر الهدي إيمانا وموعظة بالجهالة قد خابت مساعينا